begin. Oh, good. With the definition of hyperclever. Well, everybody, it was stated here a lot, I suppose. Everybody knows what it is, but let me just say a couple of words about what is hyperclever and holomorphically symplectic and so on. So a hyperclever structure on a manifold is just quaternion structure with you have three complex structures satisfying quaternion relations, and then the metric is scalar for all these three complex structures. This is one of the ways of speaking of holomorphically symplectic manifolds. First, a hyperclever manifold has three symplectic forms, just regular symplectic forms, but then you take the form, but then you take the form square omega j plus square of minus 1 omega k, and this is holomorphically symplectic. On MI. This way, every hyperclever manifold becomes holomorphically symplectic. And then the converse is also true by Kalabi-Yau theorem. I think it would be on the next slide, but from the differential geometric point of view, you can also think of this is the physicist approach to hyperclever manifolds. You can think of this Keller condition as a condition on Levi-Civita connection. Keller means that Levi-Civita connection preserves I, J, and K. And this equation means that holonomy group, which is a group of parallel transport along all paths inside your manifold, preserves the three complex structures, which means that its holonomy is PN. Okay. This was the differential geometric approach to hyperclever manifolds. Now we have this holomorphic interpretation, which would be mostly used in the presentation of Torelli theorem. So you have a hyperclever manifold is holomorphically symplectic, as written there. This is the form I mentioned. And there is a converse theorem by Yao. It follows from Yao's proof of Kalabi's conjecture, and in this version is probably due to Baville, maybe, but it was certainly well known before. A compact Keller holomorphically symplectic manifold admits unique hyperclever metric in any Keller class. This statement is a bit misleading because hyperclever metric is unique and hyperclever structure is not. But still, it's not very difficult. Also, if the holonomy is maximal, then the hyperclever structure is also unique because it's the only operators preserved by the holonomy. So now we can forget everything about differential geometry except a few bits, and just think of hyperclever as the same as in Markushevich talk, what was called ISV, irreducible is the next. Just so far it's holomorphically symplectic, but also I will assume what is written here as simple, but it is in fact irreducibility. H1 is 0, H2 0 is one-dimensional. And Bogomolov's decomposition, it is the same as irreducibility because of Bogomolov's decomposition theorem, which says that every hyperclever manifold has a finite covering, which is a product of torus and several simple hyperclever manifolds. This is, again, if you try to think in the language of holonomy, this is just Berger decomposition for Riemannian manifolds of special holonomy. So for today's talk, everything would be simple, which is ISV in Dimas' previous talk, and then simply connected, irreducible or simple, and having this kind of cohomological constraint. Okay, let me just say a couple of words about deformations. Deformation of Calabi-Yau is again Calabi-Yau, and then this holomorphic symplectic form, after a small deformation, remains holomorphically deforms to a holomorphically symplectic. So you can always a small deformation of compact Keller manifold is Keller, and then small deformation of hyper-Keller manifold is hyper-Keller. This is something not very hard to check, to prove. And then the moduli of hyper-Keller manifold is a deformation space of complex manifolds admitting holomorphically symplectic at Keller structure. It's unnatural to fix Keller structure, of course, and holomorphically symplectic structure is unique up to a constant because of our assumption. And this assumption, which is simplicity or irreducibility, this assumption is also preserved by the deformation. So now we can speak of moduli of complex structures, and the moduli of hyper-Keller structures would be an open subset in that moduli. And it is actually an open subset because if you deform, there are examples of hyper-Keller manifold which is deformed to something which is still holomorphically symplectic but no longer Keller. Okay, now let's go to Teich-Muller space. So there are several ways of thinking of moduli spaces. You can use the approach of Grothendieck with schemes, and there's a version of this approach for complex spaces, which is, I suppose, due to Fujiki. But the earlier approach, which would be more useful for today's, is the Kadaira idea. So you start with the infinite dimensional space of all complex structures. I is it's a Fréchet manifold. So it's Gothic I, but let's write it as a comp. It's a Fréchet manifold, which means infinite dimensional manifold with some regular structure of all complex structures. Of course, the hyper-Keller moduli sits inside that space of all complex structures. The hyper-Keller moduli sits inside the space because small deformation remains hyper-Keller. And then this there is an action there is an action of diffeomorphism group on that. So you can think of diffeomorphism group or its connected component as also Fréchet-Lie group. And then the Kadaira Spencer theory is essentially a way of constructing a section of this action on this infinite dimensional space. And this means that the quotient space, which is Teich-Muller space here, the quotient is a complex, always a complex variety, but in very weak sense. It is complex, but non-Hausdorff. And still, it's a very strong result. And for this is Teich-Muller space, then you can take the quotient of Teichmüller space by the rest of the diffeomorphism group, which is called the mapping class group. The mapping class group is a quotient of diffeomorphisms by isotopies. And then you have this. This is the same kind of logic which works for the curves. You have this very big space which is called Teichmüller, and it is non-algebraic typically for at least for a curve. So you have this Teichmüller and for hyperkeller as well. And then it's mapped onto the moduli space. Moduli space. And here you have the discrete group action. Well, it's not completely discrete, but it's discrete for the curve. And it's generically, at least it's some finitely generated group acting on this Teichmüller space. So if we want to learn to state something about the moduli space, we could go by this approach, namely describe Teichmüller and then describe this mapping class group. And it works. So this quotient, which I will be talking about in the last part of this talk, is described as just you describe, explicitly describe the Teichmüller and explicitly describe the group. Okay. Now, to describe the group, I will again, this was something Dima already mentioned, that we have this Bogomolov-Bavit-Fujiki form. It could be defined differently, but one of the easiest ways to define it, just to write the formula. This is good because at least you can this way fix the sign. But in fact, the easiest way to describe this is to write this theorem. So you have a pairing on H2 of M. And it is written as, which is denoted by Q. If you want its rational value, even integer value, if you like. And it is defined up to a sign, it is defined by the following formula. Integral of eta to the power 2n is equal to Q of eta eta, or Q, well, it's a pairing, so it's Q of eta eta, power n. Times the constant, but you can just set the constant 1. Here, if the problem is that if you set the constant 1, its rationality can disappear. So you can write here lambda and write lambda more than z. And again, there is a slight difficulty here, because in that definition we don't really fix the sign unless n is odd. If n is even, there is an additional choice of sign. This is why I wrote down this unpleasant formula instead of writing that as a definition. And also this formula is good because you can always look how on the basic properties of this form. The point is that this formula is not very far from the usual Hodge-Riemann pairing. In particular, on H11, this is just Hodge-Riemann pairing, and then, maybe up to some constants. But the signature and the general behavior of this form is precisely like Hodge-Riemann form. It has signature B2 minus 3, 3, and it's negative definite on primitive forms and positive definite on the space generated by omega, omega bar, and small omega by the symplectic, homomorphic symplectic form. It's just a space generated by three symplectic forms on a hyperkeller manifold. Okay, this is, but still this form is topologically defined, as you shall see in next slide. Okay, now I can, first I will just state the general theorem of Sullivan, who described the Mapping class group for any Keller manifold. There are some additional assumptions. Simply connected, compact simply connected Keller manifold, simply connected can be dropped. I mean, it's, you can assume that it has an impotent fundamental group, but for Keller it's pretty much the same as abelian. So, but this assumption is completely fundamental, you cannot avoid it, it's just false for dimension 2 and 4. For dimension 2 it's obviously false because what this theorem says, it says that the mapping class group is arithmetic. And of course we know that the mapping class group for a curve is not arithmetic. And for dimension 2, of course everything is much more difficult, though for K3 it's still true. So now we have this compact simply connected Keller manifold, we consider the group of automorphisms of the Kamoj algebra, preserved in the Patagon classes. Obviously the mapping class group, being a group of diffeomorphism, acts on the algebra of cohomology by automorphism and preserves Pantagin classes. But what he says that the natural map from the mapping class group to this automorphism group has finite kernel and image, its image has finite index. It was of course from magnum opus of Sullivan and publications of Ishes in late 70s. And the whole machinery is very, very beautiful and complicated. How he proved that? So the idea was first you interpret every topological space as differential graded algebra, and then automorphisms, homotopy automorphisms of this space would be automorphisms of the differential graded algebra. And then you interpret the automorphism homotopy type using Smale's H-cobordism as automorphisms of the smooth manifold. So up to some finite quotients and index, you can always starting from a automorphism of your homotopy type, you can always construct an diffeomorphism. And this is why he needed that. In dimension 4 it doesn't work. In real dimension 4, I mean. Okay, so let's apply now this theorem for hyper-Keller manifold. For hyper-Keller it's very useful because we know very well the group of automorphisms of the algebra of cohomology. It's known explicitly in very great detail. So you can state this theorem. Suppose you have a simple hyper-Keller manifold and this gamma zero is a group of automorphisms of its cohomology preserving the Pentagon, then it's a finite sub-index subgroup in H2 of Z of here Q is this Bogomolov Bavit-Fujiki form. So it's finite index subgroup in this orthogonal group. And second, it has finite kernel. How you prove that? First, you notice that, well, it's not completely obvious even that this there is such a map. I mean, this first part it should be proven. What we know that the Fujiki Bogomolov-Bavit-Fujiki form is preserved up to a sign by this formula. And if n is odd, it's actually the sign is also preserved. But if n is even, it could slip a sign in theory. This doesn't happen because you can write a different formula, which is similar and also due to... Yes?
I thought that there is some completely topological description given by Yijing expressing the Bogomolov form in terms of square root of a half genus. Am I mixing up this?
I think you're right, but it is much later and more complicated.
There's
And you mean the Hitchin and Savin paper on?
So that in that case it's clear that form must be preserved.
Yeah. Yeah, but it's
a different argument.
It's a different argument that I think that this a hat. You need to check that something is non-zero, which is here is easier. But anyway, so you have different formula from that one, which is used. So you, instead of taking nth the top power, you can take the 2n minus 2 power and multiply it by p1, by the first Pantagan class. And the same argument of by Fujiki, it was actually proven by Fujiki as well, says that it is some lambda prime q of eta power n minus 1. And the sign in both cases is positive. And actually, it is known that Pantagan is sign definite. So comparing these two formulas, we find that, and we know that gamma preserves the Pantagan classes. So comparing these two formulas, we obtain that the sign of the Fujiki form is actually preserved. Because if n is odd, this formula is used to show that it preserves the sign. If n is even, this is odd. So we have, again, that the sign is preserved. So this proves the first part. So the second part now we have we have to show that it is we know that we have this map from the automorphisms of the cohomology. We have this gamma zero, which is automorphisms of cohomology preserving Pantagans, and you have a map from here to O of H2MZ with coefficients and Q. What we need to show is that its form has finite, this image of this map has finite index and it has finite kernel. What we know that the automorphisms of this cohomology algebra is very big. This was proven in mid-90s that actually the whole this group acts on this cohomology. I mean, the orthogonal group of this, if you take tensor Q, then the algebra of cohomology, automorphism of the algebra of cohomology is contained, contains this group. But then this means that the automorphism sits as a lattice inside this integer group. So this this is an arithmetic subgroup inside that. And only need to check that the kernel is finite. But this is what I mentioned, that there is the obviously, so you have this map, this kernel of the map K. And every element of this kernel preserves H2. But from the action of the from multiplicative structure on cohomology, you can deconstruct your Hodge decomposition, and you also can reconstruct the Hodge-Riemann pairing, which would be sign definite because the Hodge decomposition is fixed and the corresponding SL2 action is fixed. So every element of this kernel fixes your positive definite metric. But then, if you have a discrete group fixing a positive definite metric, it's finite because it's compact. Actually, the same argument proves that the group of automorphisms of cohomology preserving Pantagan class is projected with compact kernel. Okay, and there is also another nice argument which is due to Heubrechts, and he says that the there are just finitely many components in the Teichmuller space. Of course, instead of, there are two approaches of considering this moduli space as a quotient of the Teichmuller space. So you have the moduli space of complex structures, which is Teichmuller quotient by the gamma, which is the mapping class group. But instead of that, you can take the moduli space, the component of the moduli space, say modulus 0, which would be a component of Teichmuller quotient by the subgroup of the mapping class group, which preserves this component. And what is follows from this Kohler, Motsaka and Heuberg theorem, that since there are only finitely many components of Teichmuller space, the subgroup fixing a particular component is has finite index in the mapping class group. This means that this group is actually what is called monodromy group in the complex geometry, in the algebraic geometry of the hyperkeller manifold. And this, what is written there, is a proof that the monodromy group is actually finite, has finite index inside that orthogonal group. Okay, so now let's continue to. I explained how to compute the mapping class group. Now I have to explain how to compute the Teichmuller space. Okay, so for Teichmuller space we have this period map, which also mentioned by Dima. So you have, as I told already, we always consider the manifold which has H 2,0 of M is equal C. But then suppose we have a point on the period space, on the Teichmuller space, I inside the Teichmuller. The Teichmuller, the moduli, if I would be a point in the moduli space, we wouldn't have any marking on the cohomology, because the diffeomorphism act on the cohomology non-trivially. But now this is just the moduli, the set of all complex structures, quotient by isotopies. This means that we have a fixed H2 of M, which is just H2 of our fixed manifold. And this gives us a map from Teichmuller to projectivization of H2. Written there. It's called period map. It just maps every manifold to a line written there. Well, and from the properties of Bogomolov-Babich-Fujiki form, we can easily check two things. First, that Q of LL equals 0. If L is an image, this means that Q of omega, where omega is symplectic form, is 0, but this is the same as integral of omega power 2n equals 0 over m. And this is obvious because of type decomposition. And the same argument also proves that since integral of omega of edge omega bar power n is positive, well, you can check some, there's something to check, but it's not hard. This means that Q of omega bar is positive. And this is written there. So your period map lands you inside a quadic, inside the projective space. This is a quadic condition, and this is open part of the quadic which is positive. And also this space is very homogeneous, almost symmetric. It's not symmetric, but it's very close to being symmetric, because it's a quotient of octagonal group by SO2 times SOB2 minus C1. Not sure I will have, maybe I will explain it later how this isomorphism is constructed. It's not difficult. But right now what there are two theorems already known about this period met. First, that it is a tile due to Bogomolov, and second, that it is surjective due to Huybrechts. And also, from since period space is smooth, this means that Teichmuller space is also smooth. Of course, it's not Hausdorff, so it's a bit complicated. I mean, this notion of it is non-Hausdorff manifold. But at least it is something we can work with. Okay. Now, there are some notions of general topology which can be used, applied to the period map to obtain something about the period space. So non-Hausdorff manifold topological space look like diffeomorphic to Rn. Actually, sometimes this is just a definition of manifold. Not everybody who defines manifolds assumes that it is non-Hausdorff. But anyway, suppose if you have two points, they are non-separable. I mean, Hausdorff axiom says that if you have two points, you can separate them by open subsets. So you have points X and Y. You can, Hausdorff axiom says that you have non-intersecting neighborhoods. Well, they are inseparable if this is false. If they are all neighborhoods containing X and Y intersect. And there is a nice theorem of Huybrechts, which is very useful for all this arguments, which says that if there are two non-separable points in Teichmuller space, then the corresponding manifolds are birationally equivalent. Bimeromorphically equivalent. Birationally is not, well, there could be non-algebraic. But this is especially useful because generic manifolds have no divisors, they cannot be birationally equivalent to anything except themselves. So for at least we know that the generic points outside of some countable number of divisors, all points of our manifolds are Hausdorff. There are special non-Hausdorff points, but they sit on the divisors. Anyway, we can just define this Hausdorff reduction. Suppose you have a topological space for this, the quotient over these relations, relation denoted by tilde, is Hausdorff. Then the quotient is called Hausdorff reduction. Of course, it's completely bizarre that it can ever happen, because it's even very easy, just completely elementary examples. To see that this tilde is not always equivalence, and sometimes it is equivalence, but the quotient is not Hausdorff. But somehow this works for the moduli space of hyperkeller manifolds. And this is sort of intuitively obvious, because for a hyperkeller manifold, you have for a Teichmuller space of a hyperkeller manifold, you have the period space, you have the Teichmuller, which goes to the period space. And this the period space is Hausdorff, and this map is locally an isomorphism. This means that it glues together all the bad points. And if it is possible to glue together all bad points, it's only natural that the quotient would be Hausdorff. Okay, and it is indeed true. Actually, you can state very general terms of the existence of this Hausdorff reduction. So point is called Hausdorff if it is not equivalent to anything. And then you can define what is called Wickli-Hausdorff manifold. There are two conditions. First, that all Hausdorff, non-Hausdorff points sit inside something codimension 2. I stated this about real analytic subvarieties, but you can do that in terms of Hausdorff dimension or Schütz map, whatever. It is all arguments would work. And there is the second condition, which I denote as S. And this is precisely existence of this like period type map. So you have for every point you have a continuous surjective map to Rn, which induces a homomorphism. This just means that you can glue together all non-Hausdorff points and do that uniformly on your manifold, at least locally on a point. Generally, it's not true. I mean, you can. And then it is called Wickli-Hausdorff manifold. It turns out that this condition is good enough to obtain a Hausdorff reduction. And also, obviously, this is true for a Teichmüller space. So the all problems which can arise in if you try to do something like Hausdorff reduction, actually arise in codimension 1. You can have this line with two points, and you have some extra points here, extra pieces here, and here, and something like that. Which here I wrote it like that, but it is just three points, which are somehow glued together, or two points, or. But if you are lucky enough and the codimension 1 is okay, codimension 2 works. I mean, you can always glue together all codimension 2 non-Hausdorff points to obtain this Hausdorff reduction. This is this theorem. And the quotient is locally a homomorphism, actually it would be a manifold. And for us this is very good because we have this map, which is a Hausdorff reduction of Teichmüller space. It has a nice geometric interpretation. I call it birational Teichmüller space. But it is really a birational space. I mean, it's Teichmüller space up to we glued together birational equivalent points. And then you can state this other theorem, which is pretty much a theorem about it's Torelli type theorem, which says that after we define this birational Teichmüller space, it is mapped to every component of this birational Teichmüller space is mapped to period space by isomorphically. Mm. I mean, isomorphically in the sense that it is diffeomorphism and complex, it's bihomomorphic diffeomorphism. So now, let me say a couple of words about its proof. First, you know this period space. We know it explicitly at this quotient, and you can easily see that this quotient is actually simply connected. I mean, it's just you compute exact sequence of homotopy groups for vibration. Nothing, it's nothing to do. So we have that it is simply connected, it is a tile, and if we manage to prove that it is a covering, we're done. This is the difficult thing, is to prove that it is a covering. And the problem is why it is not obviously covering, because it might have we know that it is globally a subjection, but we don't know it's locally. I mean, we could have something like many kind of varieties which are all projected onto something and some open set, and they are projected like they cover it but not one-to-one. So every point has a pre-image but not every component is projected one-to-one onto the open subvariety in the base. This is a topological picture when it can happen that an entire map is not a covering. And this is something we should avoid, we should try to prove that it doesn't happen. And the idea of a proof is that we should prove that it is really a subjection on every connected component. And for that purpose, you use hypercalor structure.
Sorry.
Yes?
This would not be sufficient, right? It could be happening that one of the same thing is, I mean, could have the same covering kind of phenomenon.
Yeah, in the next slide, there is a precise statement about this. But what I just wanted to say now, I will just next slide, and if you will have this question, please ask it again. But what I wanted to say now is that for each hypercalor structure, there is a whole S2 of complex structures. The hypercalor structure gives you its I, J, and K, three complex structures, which satisfy quaternary relations. But then you have for each I, B, and C, which lie inside the two-dimensional sphere, you have AI plus BJ plus CK square is equal to minus 1. And then this linear combination is also preserved by the Levitch-Witte connection. So it's an integrable complex structure. And for each hypercalor structure, you have the whole CP1 two-dimensional sphere of complex structures. And the important thing is that on these CP1s, the projection is one-to-one. What this is, yeah. Then, this is how one proves that something is surjective. But let me just notice also that, so what classifies this hypercalor structures? They're obviously classified, as I said in the beginning, by the Keller forms. Every time you have a complex structure and a Keller form, you have a hypercalor structure, Keller class. But the set of Keller classes for generic manifolds is very well known. I mean, it's just an open cone of inside H2, an open cone of forms of classes which satisfy eta, Q of eta, eta positive. There are two components of that, so you should pick one. And this gives you the Keller class. This gives now the whole big control over the hypercalor lines inside the twister space, and over CP1s which correspond to hypercalor structures. And for every such line, its pre-image is the disconnected union of rational curves which are bijectively mapped to this curve. Obviously, you have for each point inside the period space, you can, and each line, each vector eta, which is represents a Keller class, it corresponds to a whole CP1 of which is called generic hypercalor curve upstairs. So if this point has many preimages, every of these preimages has corresponding CP1. Okay, now, and we know also that the Techmuir space is covered by these curves. I mean, you can go by these curves from every point to any other point, and the whole picture is very, very easy to control. So now this reductivity statement that you wanted. As you see, it's a bit bizarre. I mean, in 50s, there are many people tried to do that, and they found lots of counterexamples. You can, almost every statement like that has counterexample, but fortunately this one doesn't. So we have, suppose for each open subset, what I wrote here, it's true for a general maps of smooth manifolds. Suppose you have for each open subset on downstairs with smooth boundary, and for each connected component, the corresponding restriction is surjective. This is enough for the map P to be a covering. This is again some general topology type theorem. Well, In my case, I prove it by metric geometry, but it's something you could do for as an undergraduate. It doesn't involve any difficult arguments, elementary. But if this is true, then we know that P is a covering. On the other hand, you can check that it is true because you have an open subset, you cover it with these curves, and then every curve could be lifted to every component upstairs. In particular, every two points can be connected by the... So let me draw a picture. Suppose you have a, some open subset downstairs, and you have it's a component of its preimage. And then you have two points in here. You want to prove that they both belong to this preimage here. But then you find a sequence of these twister lines connecting one to another, like that. And for each of these twister lines, you have a preimage. So you know, actually, that this preimage belongs to this connected. It belongs to this connected component. And this means that the point in the end also belongs to this connected component.
Why is this line completely contained in the...
It's not. I take this connected segment, or the twist line, but I mean, it's completely connected. It's contained in the whole deformation space, and for that you really need to do something, because it's not even obvious that you can connect everything to everything inside of some open subset. So the argument is actually quite pretty, but I'm not sure I have time to give it now. But the idea is that actually I can't to say a couple of words about that. So you can define a metric on the moduli space by saying that the distance from a point to a point is an infimum of all paths which go inside these twister lines. And then you prove that the topology induced by this metric is the same as the usual topology. And this means that for each point, the set of all points connected to that point by the segments of lines which live inside the bigger subarray is actually open. And this means that the connectedness in the usual sense, well, it's the same topology. So the connectedness in the usual sense is the same as connectedness in this going by these twister lines. So this is how one connects everything by these connected segments of these lines. Okay, so then the period space is simply connected, then it and this map is a, this period map is a covering, so it's one-to-one. So I proved this, indicated the proof of this theorem about period space. But let's now apply it to the geometry of the moduli space. I mean, everybody wants to learn it about the moduli, not about the Teichmuller. And for the moduli, there are lots of complications. Most of them are well known. The biggest of them is Newton and Merkava, who just wrote down a counterexample to the most usual statement of Torelli theorem. And another is even earlier by De Barre, right? Yeah, it is actually due to the same, as I mentioned, as Heubrecht's also noticed, that every time you have hypercalor manifolds which are birationally equivalent, they have the same periods. But even if you glue together this birational equivalent, it still doesn't work because of Nemirkava's counterexamples. And then later, Markman also found many counterexamples to the same kind of usual Hodge-type Torelli theorem. So it doesn't work. But anyway, something still works. We have this theorem which I wrote down here. Suppose I have a hypercurry manifold, a connected component of birational model A space, and let's, there's a bit of complication here. I call the quotient of birational tech Miller by the gamma the birational model A space. This is a definition. This is not a model A space of birational structures, which doesn't exist, of course. Of it's just a quotient, and it's a quotient obtained by gluing together some non-separate points, but not all of them, because there are additional non-separate points obtained as you take this quotient. But anyway, it's a nice model A space, as nice as we can get at least. And what is important is that if you intersect this quotient with some polarized component, it gives you the usual polarized model A space, which is unlike this non-present space. It's Hausdorff, quasi-projective, and generally nice. Okay, so we take this connected component of birational model A space, then this connected component is isomorphic to a quotient of period space by the gamma I, which is arithmetic subgroup and this orthogonal group. And gamma I, it is actually the monodromy group which Markman studied. It's just, so gamma I is a part, is stabilizer of the connected component of Techmuir space inside mapping class group. And since we know that there are only finitely many connected components, then know that it has, it's an arithmetic subgroup which has finite index in this. In this group. Oh, yeah, yeah, finite index in the orthogonal group with coefficient Z, thank you. Yeah, but usually the global Theory theorem is differently understood. It's understood as a statement about Hodge structures. For KT, it works, and we know that the Hodge structure always determines the complex structure. And for the big dimension, it is usually false, as we know from Nemikawa's examples, and then from Markman's examples obtained recently. But still, it sometimes it works. So this is a version of Hodge Theory theorem which you can prove and which is true. For that, of course, we need to somehow relate the Hodge structures with these quotients. And this is done as follows. So the group has four connected components which correspond to orientation of positive p-dimensional and negative q-dimensional planes. And then the group fixing the Hodge structure is actually this O plus H2MZQ. So the Q is, you don't need it actually, but this is, you just need to fix an automorphism. But anyway, this the Hodge Theory theorem is just this statement, nothing else. I mean, this is what people would. Here I just wrote down the Hodge Theory. It's a definition. You see, it's not a theorem. It's a definition of Hodge Theory theorem.
What is the isomorphism?
Yeah, yeah. This is an isomorphism. So you need to this group gamma I should be equal to the group O plus H2MZ, preserving this is subgroup preserving orientation of positive three planes. So the Hodge theory theorem is true for K3, and also it is true for, well, the important thing is that Markman computed this gamma I group. I'm not sure I have it in the next slide, I hope. Yeah, I do. So, sorry, it's... No. Yeah. So the group gamma I is a subgroup generated by oriented reflections. What does it mean? Well, it is usual reflections, but not all of the reflections preserve the positive orientation of positive plane. So if it doesn't, you replace this reflection by a negative. And this is what is called oriented reflections here. And Markman proved that the group gamma I, which is the monodrome group, is generated by oriented reflections. In this case, the monodrome group is the group generated by monodrome, but by all Gauss-Manian local systems for all cohomology. But it is really, it's easy to see that it is equivalent to the mapping class group definition. So we need this group gamma I generated by reflections to be equal to O plus, if we hope for the Hochschild theorem to be true. And it is it works just for only n, which is a prime power. When it is a prime power, that for K3, if M is a Hilbert scheme of K3, then the Hochschild theorem is true, in the sense that if you have two deformations of a Hilbert scheme with isomorphic Hodge structures, then these varieties are bimeromorphic. And for other n, it is false.
Okay, n
equal 1 is K3. For K3 it is known.
N plus 1.
Yeah.
K square.
I think no.
So 1 is not allowed.
I think. No, I'm not sure. Certainly. This is always true, so you just need to see whether it is generated by oriented reflections or not. But maybe you're right. Maybe it is considered a prime power. Yeah. No, I think maybe you're right. Yeah. Now, so this is the end. I think this is the biggest kind of theoretic. That we could possibly have for Hilbert scheme of K3, for the generalized Kummer variety, something like that, it works. I mean, there is a description of the monodrome group in terms of reflections, which is a bit more complicated, and Markman hasn't written it down. He has it only in manuscript. But there are some way to encompass all counterexamples and probably find examples for some prime powers. I don't know. And of course, for the two other examples, I don't think we have any answers, because the monodrome group is, for all grad examples, is probably not computed. Okay, thank you very much. I'm finished.